Hi, everybody. I'm Boyd Pierce, and welcome to the world-famous Sportatorium in Dallas, Texas, for another edition of Texas Championship Wrestling. So I'm substituting for Steve Harms this week, but there'll be no substitution for great professional wrestling action. You'll see English star Ted Heath take on the rugged killer from Waxahachie, Tim Brooks. The masked jackal versus former University of Louisville football player and now top-ranked grappler, young Brian Blair. And from Buzzard Creek, Oregon, Crusher Stan Stasiak versus big, awesome Bruiser Brody. But listen to the big match you'll be seeing. Eight-man elimination match. On one side, it'll be Gary Young, Gino Hernandez, Pac Song, and Crusher Stasiak, all in the ring, of course, from the stable of Playboy Gary Hart. And across the ring, the fabulous Von Erichs, Fritz, Kevin, and David, plus big Bruiser Brody. Eight-man elimination match. The first man pinned will have to leave the state of Texas for a period of 6 months, unless it is a Von Erich, who, of course, have their residence in Texas, and they will be prohibited from wrestling in the state for 6 months. But any of the other five will have to leave the state if they're the first one pinned. So lots of great action coming up. We invite you to stay with us all the way through, and we'll have the first match right after this important word.
This event, one fall with a 15-minute time limit, at 255 pounds from Waxahachie, Texas, killer Tim Brooks. 210 pounds from England, a quarter to my left, Ted Heath. Your referee, David Manning.
This is the opening event. Exciting action as the fine star dressed in white from England, Ted Heath, takes on the rugged Waxahachie and killer Tim Brooks. Both men with a lot of respect for each other here in the opening seconds, trying to feel one another, looking for the weakness to make his move on the inside and get something started in this, the first match on this week's edition of Texas Championship Wrestling, direct from the world-famous Sportatorium in Dallas, Texas. Brooks pushed against the turnbuckle in the far side. David Manning trying to step between, and Ted Heath just couldn't take away that temptation to pop one to Brooks, because he knew that in the same situation, Brooks would have done the same to him. Now you see Brooks complaining to referee David Manning. Now, this time, Heath, with his back forced into the ropes over in the far side. Swinging, blocking it beautiful. Ted Heath comes back, and with a roundhouse right uppercut, staggers killer Tim Brooks. On the left arm, Heath twisting, now bringing it down into the hand. And Brooks heads for the ropes, knowing the hold will be broken. That's his only means of escape at this time. And of course, David Manning starts the count. Heath breaks away, and Brooks, both men still stalking the ring as they have thus far in this match. Like we said earlier, they each have a lot of respect for one another. Knowing an even match such as this, hammerlock now, Heath on Tim Brooks. Heath, former great amateur great from England and Great Britain, holding a lot of records in Wales, Scotland, Ireland, all over the United Kingdom, and now in the United States. There, Brooks, dipping it over, but did you notice, holding on all the time was Ted Heath. That's why he was such a great amateur and followed it up with a great record now in professional wrestling. And talking about a great record, the next match you'll be seeing will include Brian Blair, who had a great football record at the University of Louisville. Now, since he's come into professional wrestling, is really going to the top, and you'll be seeing Brian Blair versus the Masked Jackal coming up. A lot of great action this week on Texas Championship Wrestling, so we invite you to stay with us. I'm Boyd Pierce, substituting this week for Steve Harms, who will be back with us next week. Once again, only hand and fingers was Heath, and there's Brooks grabbing hold of the rope, but David Manning this time, he didn't get into the rope, so David broke it away without breaking the hold. Brooks was leaning on it as a crutch, but it didn't work out that way for him. And all the time holding on with the hammerlock and really applying the pressure is Heath. Brooks trying to grab the head of hair. Here's David Manning walking behind to get a clear look at the situation and reversed it now. Killer Brooks on Ted Heath. And with the hammerlock this time, it's Brooks. As we look at it, there's not a fast-moving action in a match like this, but a lot of pain and endurance going on in that ring, whether you realize it or not. This is professional wrestling, the world's most exciting sport, but it can't be all run up to date all the time. But you see a great maneuver there, going back to those amateur tactics that he used in England and following it up, Ted Heath. And he comes back with the original hammerlock that he had on Tim Brooks just a few moments ago. Brooks down on his knees now. Still would like to grab a handful of hair, but David Manning right on top of the situation. Another big bout you can look forward to this week. Crusher Stan Stasiak from Buzzard Creek, Oregon, takes on big, awesome Bruiser Brody from Santa Fe, New Mexico. I know you won't want to miss that one, but anything liable to happen, and probably will when these two big ruffians get together. Of course, headline the 8-man elimination match with the first man pinned have to either leave the state of Texas, or if it's in the Von Erichs case, will still be able to live here because this is where they reside, but they'll be unable to take a match in the state for 6 months. A great 8-man match coming up. Gary Young, Gino Hernandez, Pac Song, and Crusher Stasiak versus the fabulous Fritz, Kevin, and David Von Erich plus Bruiser Brody. So it'll all be on this week. You stay with us. This is just the opening event. The legs firmly entwined against the head of Killer Tim Brooks at the 5-minute mark has gone by. Brooks draping that right arm, trying to get a little feeling in the left, and you see him still holding on to it. There he is, swinging it away. A powerful hammerlock has been applied here in the opening moments by Ted Heath. It doesn't look that way sometime when we're close to ringside, but lots of power. Look at those muscles even now in the hands and arms of Ted Heath. Now, a test of strength, butting heads there all the time, trying to get to number one position. There they go, into the clinch for the hand. Trying to hold on is Killer Brooks, and really applying the pressure and power is Ted Heath, smaller and stockier, but showing a lot of grit and determination. You hear the fans here at ringside hollering, "Come on, Ted." Brooks made a lot of enemies through the years here with his tactics that the fans don't. There he goes now, going about a test of strength. Heath shows what it's all about as he really doubles up, almost a double jointed there on the wrist of Killer Brooks. Still going, strong men stuff, really great. Oopsie daisy, down he goes, but just like he did a few minutes ago, you saw Brooks try to break the hold and get out of the anguish and pain, but holding on all the time through the flip over was Ted Heath, and he does it again and continues on the wrist and fingers of Tim Brooks, who now down on his left knee, trying to figure out some way to get away from this top English star and gain a victory of his own. Trying to go behind the eyes of David Manning and pull his hair. He does manage to shove Heath into the rope, caused the hold to be broken, and he really laid one on Ted Heath as he had him in the ropes. Now brings him out. Comes up with that power knee to the right side of the face. Then to the left. Once again, the knee against the side of the jaw and face of, and now draping it right across that chest bone, right under the chin. So you saw Brooks go from one face to the other side of the face and then firmly right across the chin, trying to actually tear it away from him. There's Heath hanging on as Brooks against the ropes in the far corner. David Manning giving a count. Heath, a fired up little Englishman now after taking those three successive knees from Killer Brooks, realizing he has to fight fire with fire to have any opportunity to gain this victory. And that's just what he's doing as he puts the left arm of Brooks under the steel cable there in that top rope. Manning trying to pry him apart. Heath putting one to the bread basket before he backs away. And you can hear the complaint from Keller Brooks to David Manning on that doubled up fist, even though Brooks has used it on numerous occasions. Eight-man elimination match coming up. Match can be won by pinfall, submission, or over the top rope to the floor. Three ways, and there, Brooks using that dog collar chain that he always brings to the ring with him, and he's really catching the wrath of referee David Manning. Said it's man against man, and no chain will be introduced in this match legally. Brooks now dropping that knee again on Heath in the hammerlock on the face down position.
10 minutes.
Once again, the right knee to the small of the back, almost down in the kidney area by Killer Tim Brooks. Heath trying to regain his footage and Brooks making sure that he doesn't. Slashing away now. There he goes, trying to get to the rope. Get just a moment of respite, get those cobwebs out of his mind where he can think clearly, and Brooks will not let him. But there, Heath with the right, coming right back, though staggering him. Killer Brooks has him over in the corner now. Going for the bear hug. Really putting the squeeze, and the fans are picking up the roar of Go Ted Go. There, clapping both of those hands across the ears of Tim Brooks, breaks it away momentarily as Brooks throws him outside the ring, onto the floor. What has he got? He's got the dog chain collar of Tim Brooks, brought it to the ring, and now it backfired on him, and you see both men outside the ring, David Manning trying to step between them as Brooks runs up the aisle. He's trying to restrain Ted Heath from going after him with that dog chain collar. Brooks brought it to the ring. You saw him use it earlier in this match. And this time it was used against him. Heath returning to the ring. We have yet to see the appearance of Killer Brooks, who all the way up into the crowd. David Manning starts the count, so Brooks will either hurry to get to the ring or lose by being counted outside.
Only 3 minutes. Time remaining for this event, 3 minutes.
Time running out. There, Heath. With Killer Brooks' own dog collar with a chain attached to it. You see begging now. Brooks, but there's David Manning trying to stop the English star, but not before he really wallops Brooks with it, slashing him with that chain portion. And Brooks exits one more time. Brooks, Heath, now the exchanging blows to the leg. kicking away. Killer Tim Brooks back in the ring, ready for action after having been slapped a couple of times around with his own dog chain. He's to the left leg. There he goes, diving across the knee.
Only 2 minutes, time remaining.
But once again slashing away. Every time that Brooks raised up, Heath was ready, but he caught him right in the chest in midsection. Going to the ring, ropes ready, leverage, coming, draping that knee across the chest and the chin at the same time. One, two, three, Killer Brooks is the winner.
27 seconds, Killer Brooks.
We'll be back with more action right after this important message.
This event, one fall with a 30-minute time limit. Ladies and gentlemen, the corner to my right, Bulldog Brower, unable to appear, suffered a shoulder separation at the hands of David Von Erich. Taking his place at 220 pounds, the Jackal. And across the ring, at 230 pounds from Tulsa, Oklahoma, popular Brian Blair. Your referee, Bronco Luby.
Action continues now on Texas Championship Wrestling. Brian Blair now taking down with the sliding shoulders of the Masked Jackal, whom we just told you in the introduction there that the original opponent for Brian Blair was supposed to be Bulldog Brower from Baltimore, Maryland, from the stable of James J. Dillon, but it didn't work out that way because Brower ran into some hard times as he had a shoulder separation at the hands of 6'7", 235 pounds, David Von Erich. So unable to appear, but taking his place, the Masked Jackal, and at moments like these is when he wishes he hadn't taken the place because Brian Blair puts him on the mat. Blair, like we told you earlier in the introduction, as we came on the air, Brian Blair, former football star for the University of Louisville, been in professional wrestling some 3 to 4 years and really making a name for himself in our wonderful world of pro wrestling, a man destined to go to the very top. Right now he has a side headlock on the Masked Jackal, who's flat on his back on the canvas. Senior NWA referee Bronco Lubitsch, the official here in this match. Talking about Brower with the shoulder separation, I'm sure it not only hurts him physically, it hurts him financially when he misses out in matches such as this, but also it hurts his pride as a veteran went down. But that shouldn't hurt it because a lot of men have or will in the future suffer at the hands of David, Kevin, and Kerry Von Erich. There goes a flying hip toss, side salte. Here comes right back in. Takedown. Brian Blair. David Von Erich, Kevin Von Erich, Kerry Von Erich, you name them all, it's no disgrace or embarrassment to be beaten by either one of these three because they're not only top stars now, but they can go all the way to the top. The only thing would keep them from winning the world heavyweight title at the same time is because there's not three of them. Each one of them equally qualified, and they're just beginning to really start their career, really making strides not only here, but all over the world as they accept top matches, flying in and out. Some of the times you don't hear about it, but through the magazines and the press media, we follow their careers. They have main event stars all over the world, along with their famous father before them, Iron Claw Master Fitz Von Erich, who some of the youngsters like Chino Hernandez and Gary Young are finding out that he still packs plenty of power in that Iron Claw. Talking about that right here this week on Texas Championship Wrestling, you'll be seeing an 8-man elimination match with Fritz joining his older sons, Kevin and David, along with Bruiser Brody against the stable mates of Playboy Gary Hart, Gary Young, Gino Hernandez, and Pac Song, plus Crusher Stasiak. You'll see it all right here. So stay right with us. Brian Blair waiting for the Jackal to break away from those ropes. He pulls him out. Side headlock now. Blair getting that extra leverage as you saw him go in the air. Also this week, before the eight-man elimination match, you'll be viewing a captain's match. It really proved to be rough and rugged. Big crusher Stan Stasiak takes on equally large, if not larger, awesome, big, whatever you want to use, it's Bruiser Brody. Boy, what great matches we're having, and you'll be seeing them all. So stay right with us. As Brian Blair continues to dish out the punishment to the masked jackal. Powerful left arm wrapped securely around the face and head of the jackal, and Blair applying the pressure. You can see the jackal trying some way to break it up. But right on top of the situation was Bronco Lubitsch, who was on his knees along with the two grapplers. Grinding it out. No spectacular moves at this situation, but a lot of damage being done. And the jackal backs Blair into the ropes. Lubitsch calls the hold to be broken now as he starts to count. Jackal thought he could get away with a smash to Blair, but Brian came right back, and now a kick to the midsection on top. Brian Blair. Right back on the face and head of the jackal. We saw Bronco Lubitsch check for a choke hold and making the motion that it was legal, not choking. Once again, the jackal pushes Blair over to the rope, turned it around. Blair, this time, has the rope, and coming right back again, the jackal smashing away. That's, boy, that's all he's been able to do. So Brian Blair's really used those fists on him, and all the time, Bronco Lubitsch is counting. Now you saw him use the thumb. And here comes a reprimand and a warning from Bronco Lubitsch. Of course, walking away was the jackal, not even denying it or talking or saying anything, but we could see it, and you see it once again, and so did Lubitsch, and here he comes. The jackal from parts unknown doesn't engage into a talking conversation with Lubitsch. Coming right back with a right. Blair retaliating to the forehead. The jackal goes in for the kill, but Brian Blair was waiting for him. Really stirred up now. A right forearm, a legal move. Here he comes with that knee. Not across the throat, but across the head. Right on the top of the head. Brian Blair really puts the power of that right knee on the jackal's head. Once again, the jackal finds himself with his head entwined, the muscular left arm of Brian Blair. There's Blair now. What? He's unlacing the mask of the masked jackal, and the jackal, full of the tights, keeps him from unmasking him here. There he goes once again, right back eagerly. Brian Blair trying to take the mask from the jackal. Into the ropes. Using that knee now, the jackal trying to really regain everything. Carrying the attack to Blair. Face first into that turnbuckle. Steel cable with a turnbuckle attached over in the corner, and using it to good advantage was the jackal. He realizes he's in trouble, and he'll have to resort to such torture and punishment if he has a chance against Brian Blair, really one of the top young stars of professional wrestling. A blow to the side of the face. Down goes Blair, and here comes a warning from Bronco Lubitsch to open up that fist. The Jackal now. Doing what Brad did to him earlier in the match, putting that left arm really, applying the pressure around the throat and the chin of Brian Blair. There's Blair reaching behind. He can't do anything about the hold that the Jackal has, but he's trying to unmask him. He's unlaced two or three of the laces in the back. There he comes up above the chin. And even though the Jackal has the hold, it looks like Brian Blair has the mask of the Jackal. But before we could reveal any kind of identity, by looking at him, you saw the Jackal pull it back down over his chin. There, it's still working. It's wearing him, but on the back, you can see where Brian Blair has loosened up those lace strings. But you'll have to give the Jackal credit. He's still holding on. That massive left arm really applying the pressure to Brian Blair, who's doing everything he can to break away. But he can't do it at this moment. But Blair still trying, really wants that mask. Hey, got it poking that finger right under, trying to bring it up. And he does once again above the chin of the Jackal. The fans are on their feet hollering. They want the mask. They want to see who is the man hidden behind the mask. Find out who it is that calls himself the Masked Jackal. A lot of people have surmised and guessed and hollered names here at ringside, but without seeing, we can only surmise. Jackal really stirred up at his four or five times to use that fist to the midsection of Brian Blair and take down. He don't want anybody messing with his mask, and of course that's reasonably understandable. If he did, he wouldn't wear it in the first place. Headbutt staggers Blair. Slash across the chest. Holding on to both ears. It's not the hair of the head. He's got on to the ears and pushing him down, literally shoving him. Raised his hands in victory, but that's not so. Just for his own egotistical purposes, because no one here in the arena knows that Brian Blair didn't give anything up. A tremendous body slam now by the Jackal. Blair flat on his back. Here he comes, draping that right knee, but there wasn't anything left to drape it on as wisely and swiftly moving out was Brian Blair. Here he comes, bringing that shoulder and back right across the knee with a drop. Blair, one, two, second strand of rope really catches him, elbow to the head. Boy, is he stirred up. Brian Blair, we hadn't seen this youngster stirred up like this since his appearance here a few weeks ago. He has gained a lot of victories, but he is stirred up. Blair going through the domino stretch on the Masked Jackal, and he's got it really firmly entrenched there. Whoa, they fall over backwards. Blair rolling over on top of the Jackal, whose shoulders were pinned. Now, Brian Blair going for the mask. He really wants that mask to the Jackal, who wisely rolls out under the bottom strand of rope.
11 minutes, 55 seconds, Brian Blair.
We'll be back with more exciting action right after this word. Hi, everybody. Boyd Pearson. I'm here alongside me is Brian Blair. And I've told you from time to time, one of the great football stars for the University of Louisville. Not only that, a great top-ranked professional wrestler since he's come into the professional ranks. But not only that, he has a great amateur background. And I know you all will be interested in hearing him tell you about it. Brian Blair, tell these folks. Not only that, but you recall a few nights ago when we was in the arena and we were talking outside, and a lot of youngsters were grouped around you, and I happened to hear one of them ask you, say, Brian, how me, young as he was, asked you, how could I become a wrestler in the future? Why don't you tell these folks just exactly what you told that youngster?
Well, you know, Boyd, first off, you've got to be in shape physically, so therefore you've got to incorporate some kind of either a weightlifting program, a running program, and a calisthenic program, and what I do, I incorporate the three of them. I lift weights and I run. I do a lot of calisthenics and stretching exercises to keep my tendons and my ligaments loosened up, because you're always applying pressure against the joint, because unlike amateur wrestling where you can just win by pinfall, in professional wrestling there's a submission also. So you've got to really be in shape, Boyd, and that's what I always tell the children. And of course, I'm sure they get harped on this a lot about staying away from the drugs and the cigarettes and stuff like that. But even though I'm sure they get preached about it all the time, the only reason they do is because it is a very important factor. And fortunately in my life, I've been around peers and stuff that have used drugs and things like this. And somehow I've just stayed away from them, and it's helped me out in the long run. I've always been an athlete ever since I was, I started amateur wrestling when I was 6 years old, Boyd. And fortunately I had a father that loved me very much, and he took me out, and he always, he'd get right down with me, he'd throw the baseball with me. And I think that's very important, is starting out at a youthful age into any type of sport, whether you want to be a golfer or a professional wrestler, a football player, a baseball player. Once you do it and once you start it, you have to dedicate yourself to it, and you really have to put everything you have into it, not only in athletics, into scholastics too. If you want to be smart mentally, you just have to put 100% into it, Boyd.
Not only that, but as I introduce you from night to night and time to time, telling people you're from Oklahoma, because I know you do have a ranch and a farm in Oklahoma, and I know you do some rodeoing. And I know the fans would be interested in hearing directly from you. How do you compare the sport of rodeo with the sport of professional wrestling?
Well, Boyd, you know, they're both kind of the school of hard knocks. I mean, you get bumped around quite a bit in both sports, and that's why I can always relate to a rodeoer. I do a lot of bulldogging, and I try to ride those bulls once in a while out there. I guess they kind of get the better of me, but one of my favorite things is breaking horses, and I do a lot of that, and I just like the sport of rodeo as a hobby.
Thank you. And also, before you go, while I got you here, Fritz Von Erich has said if he ever gets the opportunity, he's going to use that whip and strap Gino Hernandez. What do you think?
Well, I think he will. You know, Boyd, Fritz Von Erich does pretty much what he says he's going to do, and I couldn't think of anything better than to see Gino Hernandez get his fanny strapped.
Thank you, Brian Blair, for being with us. We'll be right back with more action after this.
Your next event, one fall with a 30-minute time limit, 265 pounds from Buzzard Creek, Oregon, Crusher Stan Stasiak. 300 pounds from Santa Fe, New Mexico, the corner to my left, Bruiser Brody. Your referee, Bronco Lubitsch.
How do you like your action? Rough and rugged, let's look for it here as Crusher Stasiak wastes a little time. The bell is rang, and Bruiser Brody coming right back. Two big, big men, top stars all over the world. Crusher Stasiak outside the ring. Bruiser Brody wanting to go after him, but senior referee of the NWA, Bronco Lubitsch, warning them to stay apart, get back in the ring. Here they come, one on one side, one on the other as they re-enter. Boy, this should be a whale of a battle. Bruiser Brody against Crusher Stan Stasiak. Stasiak in the long tights, both of them dressed in black, using that right fist. The man who really loves to win the matches in it. Give out the punishment with his famous heart punch with a taped fist. There is Crusher Stasiak. There he goes for it, blocking it beautiful, and grabs that right hand that the heart punching Stasiak uses. His Bruiser Brody, who has some pain of his own to dish out, and begging away. Stasiak, Buzzard Creek, Oregon's finest citizen, now in a lot of trouble. As you see, it been explained to him by Bronco Lubitsch. Brody, powerhouse, Santa Fe, New Mexico. Face first into that turnbuckle. Trying to wear him down, but he'll never stop him, because this man is rough and rugged, if you want to go that way. Bruiser Brody. Onto the muscles of the shoulder, brings him down to one knee. Crusher Stasiak on Bruiser. You may slow him down, but you'll never stop this big man like this. But if you can slow him down, you're way ahead of the game, because a lot of times in matches, just 2 or 3 minutes gone by, Brody already had his hand raised in victory. Stasiak is trying to wear the big man down. Think this is a battle. Coming up next will be the eight-man elimination match, and in that match, Bruiser Brody will be joined by the fabulous Von Erichs, Spitz, David, and Kevin, as they take on the rugged foursome with Playboy Gary Hart directing the traffic in the corner, Gary Young, Gino Hernandez, Pac Song, and this precious Stasiak, who you see now, continuing with the shoulder muscles of Bruiser Brody. You'll be seeing all of that. Boy, action at its very best, like we've said on many times. You know, in football, you got 11 men on the team, in baseball, 9, basketball, 5, but here we are, professional wrestling in the ring, world's most exciting sport at its one-on-one, and in the next match, we'll see 4 against 4, so boy, you just can't beat it. Talking about beating, that's just what Crusher Stasiak's taking right now from Bruiser Brody, as he let him regain his footage after holding on to that shoulder muscle, and Bruiser coming out using that fist and now kicking away with his feet. Stasiak coming out, and here comes Bruiser. He's after him. Get out of the way, policeman. Let me at him, as Bruiser comes by him and throws him face first into the canvas mat. Brody is stirred up and suffered the consequences as Crusher stands Stasiak. Both men battling now wildly on the outside of the ring. Bruiser biting away at the forehead of Stasiak. Lubitsch telling him to get back in the ring, and he himself coming back in. All three now, the two men and the referee. Action continues just like it was outside of the ring. Now they're inside. High in the air and coming down, and he crashed with a thud. As Stasiak rolled out just in time and suffering it all was that right knee of Bruiser Brody. And you see him now trying to hold on to it. He really come 300 pounds hurtling through there, aiming at Stasiak, only to find nothing but the mat on the bottom. There you see, holding on. Brody really injured himself. Coming high up, and if Stasiak hadn't moved in time, you can imagine what would happen to him. They'd be hauling out Stasiak, and he catches Brody. Really hangs one on him. Now you see referee Bronco Lubitsch now raising his hand.
The winner, 4 minutes, 27 seconds, Stan Stasiak.
A wild and woolly battle, Stan Stasiak the winner. You saw what happened. We'll be back. Eight-man elimination tag match after this word.
This event, eight-man team match, 4 on each team. A man may be eliminated by pinfall, submission, or be thrown over the top rope to the floor. As a man is eliminated, he will have to leave the ring until one team is completely wiped out. The first man eliminated will not be able to wrestle in the state of Texas for 6 months. If it's in the Von Erichs, they'll be able to continue living here, but will not be able to wrestle for 6 months. Any of the other 5 eliminated will have to leave the state of Texas. Your contestants on my right, Playboy Gary Hart, present the team of Pac Song, Gary Young, Gino Hernandez, and Crusher Stan Stasiak. And across the ring, the 4-man team, first, the fabulous Von Erichs, Fritz, Kevin, and David. And 300-pound Bruiser Brody. 2 referees, David Manning and Bronco Lubitsch.
Now you see him awaiting the instruction and the clearing of the ring, 4 men on each team, but Bruiser Brody, there you see he had Crusher Stasiak now retreating. Lots of controversy came up after the end of the last match that you've seen. You didn't see the controversy after the bell rung, but of course you did see Crusher Stasiak take something out of his tights and smash Bruiser Brody. That caused Brody to go down for the 3 count, And Crusher Stasiak was declared the winner. But that's not all of it. There's still bad blood between, as you saw the glaring of the introduction, Bruiser Brody on the far side, over on Stasiak's side, in fact, when I was introduced them. So that's not all that we'll ever hear from Bruiser Brody and Crusher Stan Stasiak, I can guarantee you that. There's controversy swirls, and they don't need any in this match, because the three Von Erichs plus Bruiser Brody, plus the four rugged individuals guided by Playboy Gary Hart. It's Gary Young now on Bruiser Brody starting out this eliminating match. As we said in the introduction, three ways to be eliminated by pinfall, submission, or be thrown over the top rope. Going over the top rope for any reason will eliminate you. Brody tagging in 6'7". David Von Erich, who wastes no time smashing Gary Young. David, the man that put Bruiser Bulldog Brower out of action with a shoulder separation, now with an arm drag and takedown on Gary Young. 6'7", 235 pounds, superb athlete, David Von Erich, joined by his brother Kevin and his famous father, Iron Claw Master Fitz Von Erich, and awesome Bruiser Brody to form a four-man team in this match. Against Gino Hernandez, you see his back, you see Gary Young in the ring, Pak Song Nam, and Crusher Stasiak rounds out that quartet, and Kevin chasing Gino. Kevin in the ring now, being restrained by David Manning. Pak Song Nam is in the ring. Here comes Manning now, pulling off the Korean Star. Tell him just one man from a team. Now it's Crusher Stasiak legally in against David Von Erich. Gino quickly to come in because David was in a weakened position there, and taking advantage of it was Gino Hernandez. I wonder if he would have come in under normal circumstances if David had been waiting for him. Look at David make a fast move between the legs of Gino, and here comes his brother Kevin. Kevin and Gino, really one of the bitterest feuds in professional wrestling, and Kevin has got Gino in the ring with him now, and I'm sure Hernandez would rather have one of his other three teammates. Kevin Bonnerick falling hard, and here comes Gino racing under the ropes. Gary Young in now. A lot of personal feuds being coming out now. There's Brody and Stasiak glaring at each other after the controversy in their match, the captain's match, in which Stasiak used something out of his tights to gain the victory. Head first, Gary Young throws Kevin's head in to the turnbuckle, bringing it over into the corner. As Gino now trying to be a cheerleader on the outside for his team partner, Gary Young. Mainly because the man that he has a hold on in the pint of pressure is Gino's nemesis, number one, in Kevin Von Erich. Pak Song now, Korean Star, Pak Song Nam from Seoul, Korea. 265 pounds, chopping away. There's a terrific slash along the lines of Maniac Mark Lewin is Pak Song Nam, who knows all of the torture and pressure points, an expert in martial arts, now trying to use them all on Kevin Von Erich. Kevin, one of the most popular stars around, wisely dips down in a high-flying dropkick from a prone position. Kevin Von Erich coming down with that elbow to the midsection. Now Pak Song going for the Iron Claw. Caught to him and used forcefully by his famous father, Fitz Von Erich. It's Kevin Von Erich on Pak Song. And he gains it.
Pak Song is eliminated and will have to leave the state of Texas.
Now you hear it, as I told the fans here at ringside. On the microphone, Pak Song Nam eliminated, will have to leave the state of Texas for a period of 6 months. That was the conditions of the match. The first man eliminated would have to leave the state of Texas for a 6 month period. Due to our prior commercial commitment, we'll have to pause right now in action. We'll be right back after this important word. Action continues fast and furious now. Wild and Woolly, as Pac Song Nam has been eliminated, have to leave the state. Bruiser Brody, the big awesome Bruiser Brody, really throws down Gino Hernandez, takes on Gary Young and Crusher Stasiak, who come into the action. They should have stayed on the outside, and I'm sure they realize it. Gino being thrown into the den of wolves in the form of Kevin and Fritz Von Erich. And David, Kevin doing the throwing. Here he comes, Kevin and Gino Hernandez. Arch rivals on the mat. Right, Kevin high in the air, moving out was Gino Hernandez, and suffering it all was Kevin Von Erich. Gino quick to take advantage of him and throws him outside the ring. Stasiak there ready to work him over. Forehead, Gary Hart leads Stasiak back out of the way to keep from being disqualified. Bronco Lubich on the outside, David Manning on the inside, trying to restore order. But Gino Hernandez trying to take advantage of Kevin Von Erich before he can gain his full forces back. At the throat, Gino really. And here comes, wait a minute, Fritz Von Erich with a leather belt. He said he would use it on Gino Hernandez, and he did. Wrestling fans, Fritz Von Erich, a man who'd be dealt with through the years, never boasts or never tells you what he's going to do unless he follows through, and he really welted Gino Hernandez, as you saw it. Now Kevin and Gino continue. Wild and Woolly action, we're sorry, it's just about gone. We've had a lot of excitement. We saw Stasiak take something out of his tights and use it on Bruiser Brody in their match for a controversial decision. Pac Song Nam, first man eliminated in this match, had to leave the state of Texas for 6 months. We've seen it all, and remember, Steve Harms will be back next week. Boyd Pierce saying goodbye, everybody, from Dallas Sportatorium and Texas Championship Wrestling.